अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्ताम् वंदे गुरु परंपराम ओम। We have come to almost the end of the seventh chapter. We have two more verses left, 29 and 30, that will be dealt by Drs. Raksha and Dr. Srinivas. Although we still have two verses left, if you really look, these two verses are preparation for the next verse. Traditionally, our teacher Swami Param will always give a summary of one Gita verse before he starts. In 5 minutes, I will give you what I call as the highlights of the seventh chapter. We have studied the seventh chapter, and I want you to see what is the importance. It is called Jnana Vijnana Yoga, and we have to listen to Shri Krishna with Shraddha. Shraddha means what Krishna says is gospel truth. Now, we have entered a new Shatkam, and from now on, 7th to 12th, you will see constantly three things. Each chapter will tell you more and more about the nature of God, how to download God's grace, and various aspects about meditation, which culminates in bhakti. The opening words of Sri Krishna are very superlative. He will say, listen to me, I will teach you about jnana and vijnana, about my true nature. And he says, if you know about my true nature, there is nothing that remains to be known in this life. Now, that means we need to take this chapter very seriously. In this chapter, the third verse itself says something which is very central to us. There are billions of people on this world, but Krishna says only a very small percentage turn towards God. And even among them, very few come to the spiritual aspect about God, to know more about God. And he says, a very small percentage of them become successful. Now, which means, can we be among those who will yearn to know about God? Krishna divides his nature into para prakriti and apara prakriti. And he says, both together become what is called Ishvara. Both of them are anadi. He prepares you to see God in the world around you. And all his verses are preparation for Vishwarupa Ishwara Darshana. Very in the beginning itself, Krishna does not directly say it, but he introduces what is called the Drik Drishya Viveka. Krishna clearly says, whatever you can see and experience with your sense organs is my apara prakriti, that includes your body, mind, because that is what you can experience. He says something very significant. The one who experiences and observes this world, and that is the conscious principle, that is the para prakriti, that is my higher self. So the one who's listening and the one force that is speaking is Sri Krishna in the higher prakriti. He says all the five elements, including my body and mind, is my lower nature. And in the fifth verse, the bottom part, he says, Jiva Bhutam Mahabhavo Yayedam Dharayate Jagat. That means that consciousness principle within us is what? Mayeva Sakalam Jatam Mai Sarvam Pratishtitam. That consciousness principle is responsible for the existence of the world, for the sustaining of the world, and for the whole resolution of the world. Seventh verse, seventh chapter. Very important for upasana, for meditation. Personally, I feel the second line is worth meditating upon. It says, Mai sarvam idam protam sutre manigana eva. I pervade in and through this whole world in a very invisible manner. So be sensitive to me in and through everything that you see, because whatever you see is a reflection of myself as a lower prakriti. And the one who's seeing is my higher self. Krishna helps you to come to what is called vibhuti, to see the excellence in the ordinary. Rasoham apsu kaunteya. Whenever you're drinking water, the taste of the water, the brilliance of the sun and the moon, the pranava in the omkara, the free will in human beings. So look at the vibhuti in everything and be able to see Sri Krishna. Then in this chapter itself, why are we suffering? He says, this whole world that we see is part of my maya. It is part of my Triguna. It is so attractive like Mohini, and we invest very heavily and forget the invisible para prakriti. How do we come to that higher self? Krishna gives a simple technique. He says, if you become my bhakta, and then he says there are three levels, artha, artharthi, jignyasu, and he slowly trains you to become the highest form of a bhakta or a jnani bhakta. He says it is okay to be a sakama bhakta. Initially, use bhakti to achieve whatever you want, but gradually move from sakama to nishkama. He introduces, or Swamiji tells you something, what is called bad. Bad stands for bandhakatvam, atriptikaratvam, and dukkha mishritam, if we invest too much in sakama bhakti, and the same efforts can be used for nishkama bhakti. Krishna concludes this chapter in a very beautiful way, and that is what you're going to listen from two people, Dr. Raksha and Srinivas. They will explain. I won't take charm. There are two words, which is actually the usual trick that Krishna plays. And it is over to you, Dr. Raksha, to explain verse 29.
Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Now we have come to the concluding verses of chapter 7. Verses 29 and 30, the Jnana of Vijnana Yoga, the Yoga of Manifest and Unmanifest. Like sir said in the preceding verses, Lord Krishna has shown us how those who adore him attain the supreme. I would like to mention verse 26, where Lord Krishna declares, Vedaham, he knows, Samatitani, Vartamanani and Bhavishyani. He knows all the beings, past, present, and even those that are yet to come. But none knows me. In verse 28, he says, those blessed souls who have been performing through successive births, through all the austere practices, reflecting by the mind and intellect, and worshipping God in every way, the one who is a virtuous devotee, such a person with a firm resolve comes to know him properly, his integral being, and attains him. These two verses, 29 and 30, pave the way for the next chapter, Akshara Brahma Yoga, where in the first two verses, Arjuna asks questions, Kim Tad Brahma, Kim Adhyatmam, Kim Karmam, and so on. Here coming to my verse, verse 29, Jara marana mokshaya mama shritya yatantiye te brahma tad viduhu krishnam adhyatmam karma chakilam ye mam ashritya. One who takes refuge in me, jara marana mokshaya yatanti, they strive for deliverance from old age and death, te viduhu, they know, Tat Brahma, that Brahma, Krishnam Adhyatmam, the whole Adhyatma, and Akhilam Karma, the entire field of karma. Here, Jaramarana Mokshaya, Jaramarana is samsara. Jaramarana Mokshaya is freedom from samsara or the bondage, the cycle of Punarapi Jananam, Punarapi Maranam. Samsara has many problems, the most dreadful being old age and death. And how do we get over this? By knowing the ultimate. Bhagavan Sri Krishna is introducing a series of technical terms that a devotee needs to know. In this verse, they are Brahma, Adhyatma, and Karma. Tat Brahma. Tat Brahma refers to the absolute formless, the supreme reality, the embodiment of truth, knowledge, and bliss, the Sachidananda Swarupa, Nirguna Brahma, or Paramatma. Adhyatma is the second term with its attribute Krishna, which stands for the totality of the individual's soul. This is the pervading consciousness within the individual. And karma, again, karma is Akhilam Karma, the entire field of action. This is the great discharge by God, which brings forth the existence of being, which is in itself a supreme cosmic sacrifice. In verse 1 of this chapter 7, Lord Shri Krishna had said, he told Arjuna, Maya Sakta Manaha and Madashrayaha, sole refuge in me with your mind fixed on me. Again, he emphasizes the same in verse 29 and 30. Here he says, Yukta Chetasaha, with a steadfast mind, Mam Ashritaha, take refuge in me. Katopanishad says, Nayamatma Pravachanena Labhyo, Na Medaya Na Bahuna Shrutena. Brahman cannot be known by spiritual discourses, nor through the intellect, nor by the study of many Vedas. Only when he bestows his grace, the fortunate soul comes to know him. Upanishad says, Ekasmin Vignatam Vignatam Bhavati. The experience of Satchit Ananda is knowing everything. Hari Om, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Raksha, for a nice explanation of this verse. We go to the last verse. Dr. Srinivas, it is your time. Hope there is no unmuting problem. Dr. Srinivas?
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir. Yeah, I'll repeat it.
Sir, you have to unmute.
Your volume is very low. A little higher.
Can you hear me, sir?
Very soft still.
Sir, can you hear now? Sir, can you hear, sir?
Your volume is very low.
Srinivas.
Increase the volume on the phone.
Yeah, yes, sir. Increased. How is it now, sir?
Slightly better. Okay.
Sadi Bhutadi Daivam Mam. Sadi Yajnam Cha Ye Viduhu. Prayana Kale Picha Mam. Te Vidur Yukta Chetasaha. So, in this shloka, this is the last shloka. So, let us see the second line first. We have two sandhi words in this. Prayana Kale Pi. Prayana kale plus api. This is a Purva Rupa Sandhi. You can see a reverse S-shaped symbol in that. Prayana kale and reverse S-shaped symbol and P. So that is called as avagraham. So what we have to do is, we have to just put A in that. So prayana kale api. So this avagraham frequently comes in many shlokas. So that's why I'm telling this. So how we should pronounce is prayana kale. Little bit we have to drag it between rasvam and dirgam. It should not be, the lay should be not as rasvam or should not be as much as dirgam. So prayana kalepi, like that we should pronounce it. So this is about prayana kalepi. Vidur yukta chetasaha. Viduhu plus yukta chetasaha. This is a visarga sandhi. Viduhu is the visarga. Uhu is becoming refa. That is vidur yukta chetasaha. That ar is what is sandhi here. So these are the two sandhis in this second line. So next, let us see A in the first line. Sadhi yajnam cha ye viduhu. A means yaru. In Kannada, it is yaru. It's better to understand Sanskrit in our Indian languages rather than in English. It will be more easier. So it gets anvaya with te. Te means avaru. Yaradre telidu kollutaro avarige. Like that gets anvayam. So here, coming to the first line, we have the Bhagavan has introduced three words here. Sadibhutam, adibhutam, adidaivam, adiyajnam. So sa is included here. So why it is sa is adibhutena sahitaha sadibhutam, adidaivena sahitaha sadidaivam, adiyajnena sahitaha sadiyajnam. This is the tritiya vibhakti is included here. So what he wants to tell is, I am made up of these three things. That's the meaning. So, Ramena Sahitaha Sita Vanam Gachati. So, with Rama, Sita went to Aranyam. That's the, Sita went to forest. So, with all these things, Sadi Bhutam, Adibhutam, Adidaivam and Adiyajnam. Whoever knows me, that I am made up of this. Viduhu is the Kriyapadam here. Viduhu means Veda. Vidatuhu, Viduhu. This is the Ekavachanam, Divachanam and Bahuvachanam. Vid is the root word from which Viduhu is derived. Vid means to know. Even the word Rigveda, Yajurveda also, they are derived from this word Vid. So whoever knows me as composed of these three things, so like that, Sadi Bhutadi, Sadi Daivam, Mam means Nannannu. Whoever knows me as made up of these three things, that person, Prayana Kalepi means Marana Samaye Api. So towards at the time of death, so he will know me with a balanced mind. Te Viduhu, those people will know me with a balanced mind. So this is the meaning of this shloka. So the purpose of what Bhagavan is telling is, whoever knows that I am made up of these three elements of Adibhuta, Adidaivam and Adiyajnam during their lifetime, not at the time of death. So you cannot say I will do all the, I will enjoy the prapancha vishyas and at the end of the end, just before I die, I am going to say, I'll remember your name and I will get moksha. That is not possible. So we all know that at the time of death, most of the times we will not be of a balanced mind, and the pain will be, Shastras say, the pain will be as much as 1 lakh scorpions when they bite. That much pain the patient experiences. This is what Shastras says. Probably we see in the ICU also, they will be in severe distress. That may be possible also. So we should know the Bhagavan about in the lifetime, so that we will know him, remember him and meditate him at the end of the lifetime. So that is the Prayana Kalepi. It's a brief explanation of these three words. What is Adibhutam, Adidaivam and Adiyajnam? Adibhutam means perishable existence of everything that has a birth. Adidaivata means the Hiranya Garbha, that is the universal soul, the sustainer and stimulator of the sense organs. So even both these things belongs to Paraprakriti itself. So Adidaivata, Hiranya Garbha, if you have seen in Tattva Bodha earlier, infinite reality when expresses through its own creations is called Ishvara. Infinite reality when it's identified with the urge to create is called as Hiranya Garbha. And the infinite reality when it identifies with the gross total body is called Virat Purusha. And the infinite reality when it identifies with the individual entity is called Jiva. So these are the three explanations of the words and the meaning of the shloka. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas. As usual, we learn a lot of grammar when you explain these verses. And with your explanation, we have come to the end of an amazing 7th chapter, which we need to revise again and again. With that, we go on to Akshara Brahma Yoga, which is Swami Param calls it an odd man out chapter.
So, sir, I just chant the closing, the chanting, sir?
Okay, please chant for me.
Om Tatsat Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gitasu Upanishatsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre Shri Krishna Arjuna Samvade Jnana Vijnana Yogo Nama Saptamodhyayaha. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Venkatesh. Yes. Once upon a time, I thought this was not an important chapter because Swamiji also was talking that this is an odd man out, not working for Sadhyo Mukti, but for Krama Mukti, and deals with very negative aspects. But each time I studied, you'll see the importance of this chapter. We have the opening speaker, Ullas. It is your time to explain verse 1.
Hari Om, sir. As we are entering into a new chapter, the 8th chapter, I would give a brief summary of how much ever Gita we have dealt so far. So as we all know, Gita is divided into three logical groupings, the Prathama Shatkam, first 6 chapters, Madhyama Shatkam, the next 6, and the Charma Shatkam, the last 6. And the first one, it talks about mainly three things, which are Jiva Swarupam, Jiva Prayatna, and Karma Yoga. In the Jiva Swarupam, Krishna already tells that Jiva itself is also not a perishable body or the changing mind, but rather we are the changeless consciousness principle. So that is the Jiva Swarupam. In the Jiva Prayatna also, it was told that our individual effort is also very important. We should not have fatalistic approach that whenever something wrong happens, we would say, no, anyway, there is not much that I could do about it. It's all in the God's hands. It's all already written. It's a very dangerous approach. We've all been given free will. We can write our own destinies. So we have a significant contribution in that and what happens to us. So we must realize that. And then the third sadhana that it was talked about was Karma Yoga. How do we see inaction in action? How do we have the Ishvara Arpana Bhava while we are doing something and Prasad Buddhi when we are receiving something? Then in the Madhyama Shatkam now, the analogous topics are, instead of Jiva Swarupam, we are talking Ishvara Swarupam. So we talked about what is the formless and formed God. And what we also saw the two aspects of para and apara in the seventh chapter. Basically, the para and apara is nothing but consciousness and the matter principle. And then it talks about that Ishvara is the combination of para and apara, and then world is also that. So you see me only in the world also. Then the second thing, as compared to Jiva Prayatna in the Prathama Shatka, it talks about Ishvara Anugraha. That there is a lot of contributory role of Ishvara also. Not that everything is dependent on just my individual effort. Like for example, that there is a locker. In both my key as well as the operator's key, both are as important and needed. Then only the locker would open. And then similarly, instead of Karma Yoga, now it talks about Upasana Sadhana. What is the discipline of meditation upon God? And then once you get the Jnana Yogyata, then we enter into Jnana. Now, the solution for removing all the reliance from Apara was told as Bhakti in the seventh chapter again. Then it talks about that Bhakti, there are different types of Bhaktas also. And then one might think that Bhakti might be of another way to Moksha. But Bhakti is only relevant if it takes us to Jnanam. So Bhakti is also a sadhana which takes to Jnanam. Then Krishna at the end says that there are two types of Bhakti, Sakama and Nishkama Bhakti. Sakama is also a means to reach to Nishkama Bhakti. Then he says that who has Nishkama Bhakti will only gain proper Ishvara Jnanam. But now he uses his trick, and instead of saying he will gain Ishvara Jnanam, he uses different technical terms, which are nothing but a combination of para and apara only. So, but because if he wouldn't say those terms, the Gita would end there only. So, to introduce more things so that he can teach Arjuna, he introduces six new terms, which is all about the eighth chapter. So, now we enter into the eighth chapter, which is just answering these seven questions. Actually, the real motive of Krishna is to introduce Saguna Ishvara Uddhanam. Once we do that, again, that is a stepping stone to go to Nirguna Ishvara. So he needs us to do Upasana. Now he starts with a question, that the chapter starts with a question that Arjuna asks. The chapter is called Akshara Brahma Yoga. Why? We will see in the third verse. Now let me chant the verse. Arjuna uvacha kim tad brahma kim adhyatmam kim karma purushottama adhibhutam cha kim proktam adhidaivam kim uchyate. In 29 and 30, Krishna mentioned a lot of technical terms. So now Arjuna is not able to understand. He was understanding para and apara, but now he's asking, Kim tad brahma? Who is this Brahman? What is this adhyatmam? In 29, he talked about those. And then karma, dictionary meaning is action. But what does it technically mean here? We will see all these answers in this chapter. And he also asked that he mentioned in verse 30, what is this adhibhutam? Please tell me, what is adhidaivam? Kindly help me understand, O Purushottam. He is not just asking an ordinary friend. He is asking a Purushottam, who is the authority on this knowledge. So these are the few questions. The last two questions will be asked in the next verse. Hari.
Thank you, Ullas, because there is nothing much in these two verses, the first and second verses. So it's very good you took an opportunity to give a little overview of the Shatkams and the previous chapter altogether. We have the next speaker in one. Anupama.
Shall I start, please?
Please go ahead.
Adhi yajnaha katam putra ehesmin madhusudana prayana kale chakatam neyosi niyatatma bihi. The meaning, kaha adhiyajna katam vardate? Who is adhiyajna? In what form does he remain in this body? And how should he be meditated upon? The next question, prayana kale katam jneyaha asi niyata atma bihi? How are you, the Lord, to be meditated upon at the time of death, prayana kale, by a disciplined upasaka? Chapter 7, verse 30 that we just heard is a Sutra Krama Mukti Shloka, which has been elaborated here in Chapter 8 with Prayana Kale as the crucial verb. Krishna had mentioned the six technical words which Dr. Ullas just mentioned at the end of Chapter 7, and these words are described as Prashnam Bhijati Upadishtani words, or question leading words. Arjuna is not even expected to understand these words. A guru assesses his student by this technique. So if a student just nods his head as if he has understood, not only is the guru surprised, but he also realizes that the student is not interested in any further explanation. But Arjuna, being a jignasu, asks these questions for clarification. The sixth word in this sequence is adhiyajna. Adhiyajna katam kaha. Kaha adhiyajna means who is adhiyajna. Atra asmin dehe katam chintaniya. Here, in this body, how should adhiyajna be meditated upon? Saguna rupena va, nirguna rupena va, and what is the prayojanam or katam vardate? How does adhiyajna remain in this body? Sakshi rupena va? These are questions to be answered. The next question, the last one. Prayana kale katam jnyeyaha asi niyata atma bihi. Here atma means mind. Niyataha atma antakarna yasya taihi. How are we to remember the Lord, the Saguna Ishwara, at the time of death? Now, this is applicable to the Saguna Upasaka seeking Krama Mukti and not the Jnani who already is a Jivan Mukta. Any further explanation would encroach upon the subsequent verses, but there is just one word remaining here in no man's territory which I shall try to explain. What is the meaning of Madhusudana? Madhusudana is the destroyer of a demon called Madhu. Madhu and Kaidaba are the two asuras destroyed by Krishna. Here, there is a philosophical meaning also. Madhu, the Rakshasa, symbolizes Ahankara. Madhu means honey, a dear one. But the dearest one for everyone is Ahankara or Jiva Bhavaha. So dear that we cling on to this triangular format and refuse to come to the binary format. Our attachment to Ishvara is only as a means originating from our attachment to Jiva Bhavaha, the Ahankara. So what does Bhagavan do? Bhagavan, in the form of Brahma Vidya Guru, destroys the Madhu, the Ahankara, the Jiva Bhavaha, or the triangular format, and brings the disciple to the binary. Madhu Namanam Ahankara Rupa Rakshasam Sudayati Nashayati Iti Madhusudana. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much, Anupama, for both of you. Ullas and Anupama handled it in a very unique way, because there is nothing much other than translating these verses. Or very boss, you rightly did, didn't encroach into the next speakers who will have nothing else to speak if you explain all these words. Sachin, it's your turn. Verse 3.
The Kala Tattva. Sri Bhagavan Uvacha Aksharam Brahma Paramam Vabhavodhyatma Muchate Bhuta Bhavodbhavakara Visarga Karma Sang. Here, actually, there is an exam or teacher himself here, because Arjuna is asking questions, seven of them, and there is no exception given for the questions. All questions have to be answered. The title Akshara Brahma Yoga has come, is known from this verse. The first three answers are given out of the six questions asked in this verse. So, Brahman, what is Brahman? So, here, Akshara Brahman. Akshara means imperishable. The root word, of this word is Sharaha. Nakshara iti Aksharaha. That means imperishable one. And to this, Paramam is an adjective added by Lord Krishna, which means the highest or the greatest of all. So, in Mundaka Upanishad also, that we have known this in the fifth verse, that is Tad Aksharaha. That's how Brahman is known. Now, this is the only thing that is imperishable. Rest, all things are perishable. Sarvagata Chaitanya Tattvam is the principal consciousness, the all-witness, all-pervading, and this is the original consciousness, which is known as Brahman. Rest, all is matter. Even our own body, which we are so proud of, is a matter, and which will decay or destroy, which will perish. That is all dealt in Apara Vidya, Apara Prakriti in 7th chapter. Now, Brahman is an eternal consciousness, and that is again coming from the root word Briha, meaning big, superlatively big. That which is superlatively limitless entity, also called as Ananta Tattvam, and that is what is called as Brahman. Here, Krishna is very brief in his answer because he has already dealt this in 7th chapter, the verse 4 to 10. Coming to the second answer is Adhyatmam. Adhya Atmaha. Atma here is the Shariram, the Vyashti principle or Vyashti Prakara of the Jivatma. And as Brahman is all pervading, the consciousness is in the Jiva is called as Adhya Atmaha. So the if you see at a micro level, the consciousness inside the Jiva is Adhyatma. As we all know, in every wave, there is the principle which is water, and in every ornament, the principle of gold. Similarly, the consciousness is present in the micro Shrishti is the Adhyatma. Now, why these two different names? One is for the Brahman, one is for the Adhyatma. That is just the Shabda Prakriti Nimitta. That means a person is known to the wife as a husband. The same person will be known to the children as a father and for the his parents as a child. So it is just the Nimitta of the nature of the Prakriti. So coming to the third answer is Karma. Karma here is also referred as Bhuta Bhavad Vakara Visarga. Visarga refers to all the activities, all those actions that are deliberate actions of human beings, which are responsible for future creation, is called karma. And in our scriptures, it is clearly indicated that there is no creation which is incidental, or sorry, accidental. All creations are incidental, caused by the previous karmas or action which were deliberate by that Srishti. And similarly, if we look at our own micro world, then every karma done even by the tiniest mosquito to the biggest, hugest mammal, that is the dinosaur, is all having karma at a given time. And that particular will bring about the previous Srishti and the future Srishti. Therefore, Krishna says, Bhuta Bhavaha. That means the insistence of the living being, Udbhava Karaha, means that which brings about the existence of every living being is not only humans, but from a mosquito to a dinosaur. Therefore, what is karma? Karma is Srishti Karanam Karma. That which brings about the previous Srishti, and because of the present karmas, will bring the future Srishti. And our contribution is called as the Karma Sanjitaha. That's all from the word. Thank you.
Thank you, Sachin. You have explained each word as clearly as possible. And that is the first chapter of all these terms.
Audible, sir?
Clear. Go ahead.
Okay. So, in the previous verse, we have seen Krishna explaining three terms, that is Brahman, Adhyatmam, and Karma. Now, Krishna goes forward to answer further three words in this particular verse. The verse goes like this. Adibhutam ksharo bhava purushascha adhi daivatam adhi yagno aham yevatra dehe deha brutam varam. So each of the line he says adibhutam ksharo bhavo. Kshara is a perishable. Kshara bhava is the perishable entity. So adibhuta is all the perishable entity. Every perishable thing in the creation is called Adibhuta. So thus, any object that we experience is Adibhuta. The five elements, space, air, water, fire, earth, sun, moon, star, etc., river, mountain, even our physical body, all constitute this Adibhuta. So that is fourth question answered. What is Adibhuta? Now coming on to the second line, Purushascha Adi Daivatam. He is answering what is Adi Daivata. Adi Daivata is Purusha. Purusha, Purusha here refers to the Hiranyagarbha. So in Shastric language, Hiranyagarbha is total consciousness associated with total mind and therefore associated with total knowledge. When we go back to Tattva Bodha and see what Hiranyagarbha is, it is Samashti Sukshma Sharira Sahita Chaitanyam. That is Hiranyagarbha. So consciousness associated with total subtle body. And that Hiranyagarbha alone is called the presiding deity from the standpoint of every organ. For eye, it is Surya. For ear, it is Digdrevata. For skin or the form fill, it is Vayu. For the taste, it is Varuna. For smell, it is Ashwini Kumaras. So these deities from presiding point, from the standpoint of every organ, form Hiranyagarbha, and those are Adi Daivam. And thus, fifth question is also answered. Now coming on to the sixth question, what is Adi Yagna? Krishna refers here in the third line, Adi Yagno Aham Evatra, Aham Eva is me, myself, the Lord himself. So Ishvara himself is Adi Yagna. When you go back to Tattva Bodha again, Ishvara is defined as consciousness associated with total Karana Prapancha, that is causal body. So whole universe in potential form. Krishna says he is the seed of the universe. We might have seen in many temples, Krishna, a small Balakrishna on banyan leaf, that represents the seed of the universe. When the pralayam occurs, this Krishna over banyan tree keeps flowing, and that is a representation of seed of the universe. So, Samashti Karana Sharira Sahita Chaitanyam is this Adi Yagna. So he has answered all three terms here, but the verse explanation doesn't complete here. When we go back to verse 2, Krishna, Arjuna has asked, Katham Atra Asmin Dehe, how does this Adi Yagna remain here in this body? So Krishna goes further to answer that particular question, what has been asked in verse 2. Here we have seen that Arjuna has referred Krishna here as Madhusudana. So we have seen beautiful explanation of Madhusudana as well. Now here Krishna refers Arjuna as Dehe Bratam Vara. Dehe Bratam Vara means the greatest human being, and that Arjuna definitely is. So Krishna has told that Lord himself, that Ishvara himself, is Adi Yagna, and that he resides in the body, and not even just this chapter, in chapter 18 as well as in chapter 10, Krishna says that Lord resides in every human being. But coming to the answer of how he remains in this body is, Yagna means every prayer or puja or action we do. Adi Yagna means Lord is associated with every action we do. Every small action we do, whether good or bad, is registered, and karma phalam is given according to law of karma. So every enjoyment or suffering is the result of our own action, and Adi Yagna means karma phaladata. So Krishna says Adi Yagna is karma phaladata, and he stays in that form in every human being. We can refer to Narayana, that is Nara and Naram and Ayanam. Naram is Samasti, Jiva Vastu, all living beings. Ayanam is residence. So Narayanaha means Lord is residing in all beings, all human body, all living beings. Thank you.
Thank you, Satya. You dealt with every aspect of this verse. There is nothing left to be explained. That's how it should be done. Complete. Dr. Meenal, it is your time. Verse 5.
Hariyom. Verse number 5. Antakale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram yah prayati samadbhavam yati nastyatra sanshayah. The previous two verses, that is verses numbers 3 and 4, which Dr. Sachin and Dr. Satyanarayan so beautifully explained to us just now, are the answers given to the first six questions that were asked by Arjuna. And from this verse number 5 onwards, up to verse number 28, Krishna very elaborately answers the 7th question as posed by Arjuna. So 2 verses for 6 questions and 24 verses just for 1 question. So just to refresh, the 7th question was Antakale or Prayanakale Ishvara Smaranam. The significance of Prayanakale Ishvara Smaranam and how to remember God at the time of death. The answer to this question starts with this verse, and by answering this question, Krishna introduces the topic of Saguna Ishvara Upasana or Sadhana of God with attributes, also called as Saguna Brahma. Saguna Ishvara Upasana is of two types. Sakama Saguna Ishvara Upasana, which is done for material benefits. And the second type is Nishkama Saguna Ishvara Upasana, which is done for spiritual benefits and spiritual growth. When the sadhaka's goal is God himself, that is, he craves for Ishvara Aikyam Prapti, which is also called as Moksha, the Upasana is going to require detachment or Vairagyam. A Vairagi Bhakta becomes a Nishkama Bhakta. Such a Nishkama Bhakta can take one of the following two paths. In the first path, he practices Nishkama Saguna Ishvara Upasana for some time, then becomes qualified, then gets Nirguna Ishvara Jnanam in this birth, and obtains Jivan Mukti, Moksha, which is also called as Sadyo Mukti or Akrama Mukti. That is, he gets Moksha right here and now in this birth itself. In the second path, the Bhakta will continue Saguna Ishvara Upasana because he is not able to grasp or understand the Nirguna attributeless Brahman. At the time of death, this Bhakta will remember the Saguna Ishvara of his choice, which can be Krishna, Rama, Devi or Shiva, and prays very sincerely for Moksha. Such a Jiva will definitely reach Brahma Loka and get Nirguna Ishvara Jnana from none other than Brahmaji himself. And having obtained Nirguna Brahma Jnanam, subsequently this Jiva will get Moksha. This is called Krama Mukti. So with this background, now let us look at the verse. Antakale cha mameva smaranam. The Bhakta who remembers me only at the time of death, Kalevaram Muktva. Kalevaram is the body. Muktva is free or leaves. So when such a jiva leaves the physical body, what is implied is the jiva travels. Yaha prayati. Yaha refers to the Nishkama Saguna Ishvara Upasaka. Prayati is dies. Sa Madbhavam Yati. This bhakta, that is sa, Madbhavam here represents Krama Mukti. Gets Krama Mukti. So again, here it is to be noted that Krishna does not really describe the intermediary stages or the sequence which we just discussed now, but it is implied. A Saguna Ishvara Upasaka can only obtain Krama Mukti. He can never get a Akrama Mukti or Sadyo Mukti unless he gets Jnanam of Nirguna Ishvara. Nasti Atra Sanshayaha. Krishna ends this verse by giving a virtual guarantee to us that there is no doubt that such a Saguna Ishvara Upasaka will ultimately come to him only. Thank you, Hari Om.
Thank you, Dr. Meenal. It's each person excelling the other. That's how today's class has been. And Dr. Sundar, the onus is on you for the last verse, and I'm sure you'll do a good job. Verse 6.
Hari Om, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Yam Yam Vapismaran Bhavam Yajat अन्ते कलेवरं तं तमेवैति कौन्तेय सदा तद्भाव भाविताः डॉक्टर मीलनल ब्यूटिफुली एक्सप्लेन्ड दैट दिस चैप्टर इज अबाउट सगुण उपासना एंड अ पर्सन इनिशियली मे हैव अ सकाम फॉर्म ऑफ भक्ति. Then Pariksha Lokan, Karma Chitan, kind of an awakening happens, and then he shifts to Nishkama Bhakti. And having done Nishkama Bhakti, that is, now he has shifted from Artha Arthaarthi type of Bhakta, he has become a Jijnyasu Bhakta. Now having done that for some time, he gets the spiritual phalam which was promised, which is actually Sadhana Chatushtaya Sampatti. Having obtained Sadhana Chatushtaya Sampatti, this Jijnyasu Bhakta has now two roots in front of him. He is lucky, he gets a guru, there is benefit of Shastram, he is able to Shravana Manana Nididhyasanam, then he takes the route of Jivan Mukti, Videha Mukti, which is Sadhyo Mukti. There may be unfortunately no availability of Guru or Shastram for some reason, not able to do Shravana Manana Nididhyasanam, but he has Sadhana Chatustaya Sampatti. In that case, this chapter Krishna addresses to say that he may continue his Nishkama Bhakti till the end of his life, and then he promises, like Dr. Meenal said, virtual guarantee that he'll go to Brahmaloka, where he'll get the best of the Vedanta Gurus in the form of Brahmaji himself, and then from there he'll get Mukti. So in the previous verse, Krishna said, if you remember me at the time of death, then you'll attain to me. In this verse, the same, he is generalizing to a rule to say, yam yam vapi smaran bhavam. Bhavam here refers to thoughts. These are thoughts of anatma, thoughts of objects. So such anatma thoughts, smaran means if you keep remembering, yam yam means whenever, whenever. So whenever you remember anatma thoughts, especially so at ante, means at the time of death, chajet kalevram, when you are dropping your body, then what happens? Tam tam eti, you are going to attain to that so ever object that you have been kind of dhyanam or meditating all throughout your life, or you will get a birth which is favoring those kinds of objects in your next life. So whatever you think you become, Swami Param gives a beautiful quote that watch your words, they become your thoughts. Watch your thoughts, they become your action. Watch your actions, they become your habit. Watch your habit, they become your character. And then the character becomes destiny. So in a way, this word says what we are going to get in our next Janma is written now itself. It is now in our hands. Now, somebody can say that however I am throughout my life, there is a shortcut given by Krishna here. He has given a virtual guarantee that if I remember him at the time of death, then I'll attain to him. Now, it is when we are hale and hearty itself, remembering God and doing puja with remembrance every day may be difficult. Then how is it possible that one will remember in pain at the time of death? So, and plus it is never predictable when death is going to come. So the trick is given in the last words, sada tadbhava bhavitaha. Sada means always. Tad refers to God. Tadbhava, sada tadbhava. So always have God thoughts. Bhavitaha is an important word. It means to say that our thoughts, which are God thoughts, should be saturated in our subconsciousness. Very rarely we act it should be saturated in our subconsciousness. So it is said that the subconsciousness is a constant clash between the will, which is driven by the intellect, and the vasanas, which are driven by the mind. So there has to be a balance, an equation between the will and the vasanas. So we should use our intellect, and we should always have sadrupa vasanas developed in our mind. So if my subconsciousness is therefore saturated with God thoughts, then it will always be in the background like a shruti. Then automatically I will remember God. I'll do smaranam even at the time of death. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sundar. Another brilliant presentation. And all the presentations today were so brilliant. I enjoyed each one of them. I would like to spend just a few minutes on the theme. Once upon a time, I told you, I thought this was a very chapter that we need not give too much importance. But as you go along, you will see this coming again and again about our own death. And that is why in these few minutes, I would like to speak something about one of the most difficult spiritual approaches is to be able to accept our own death. I will share a certain Sufi story which you would be familiar. A certain king wakes up with a bad dream. And in that dream, he saw the messenger of death come and tell him, tomorrow evening at sunset, be ready, I'm coming to take you. He is a little disturbed. He does not know if it's a premonition. He calls the astrologers, he calls all the wise people. They all assemble and they go on discussing and discussing, and they cannot come to a conclusion. The king's personal servant tells him, Maharaj, I feel that the palace is not a safe place for you. I want you to go as far as possible. He takes the best horse. He runs away from the palace. It is getting to be sunset time. He gets down from the horse far away. And then he pats his horse and says, you've done a good job. And as he looks back, he sees that very same face he saw in his dream. Come to the same horse, pats it and says, you've done an excellent job. You have come to the right place at the right time. This is a story about death. However fast we run from it, we cannot escape the time and the place of death, which is probably already destined. We do not know when and how and where we will die. But with my little understanding of all the karma theory, this point is certainly decided. And therefore, we don't have to worry too much because we are going to die only once. So all we need is the courage to accept that which cannot be changed. I remember Parikshit was told that he had 7 days to live. And when somebody asked him, so unfortunate, you have only 7 days to live. He says, I know I have 7 days. How many days do you have? We do not know that. Let us analyze a little about death so that the more you look into death and the more you look into life, it is possible that you will come to a certain amount of acceptance. Because normally we think of death as an enemy. Teachers say death is not the enemy. It is a part of life. We think death is against life. We think death as the enemy. Death is not the enemy. Death is an integral part of life. Where there is life, death is there. The more we are able to understand life, we will be able to understand death. Remember that life and death are two sides of the same energy, the same phenomenon. They are not separate, they are not opposites, they are complementary. Death is not the end of life. In fact, it is the completion of one life. And if a life is lived well, it is the crescendo, the climax, and the finale of one life. And once you know what death is and all the aspects about once you know about life, then you know what really death is. Then you will be able to accept that death is an integral part of life. Life exists because of death, because death is a constant process of renewal, and death happens also each moment when life happens. Now let us take the aspect about breath. In breath, there is both life and death. When a child is born, the first thing a child does is to breathe in, and life starts. When an old man is dying, the last thing he does is to breathe out, and then life departs. Breathing out is death and breathing in is life. That is why breathing out is also called to expire. If you are able to live and if you are able to live in life moment to moment, you will see every moment life happens, every moment death happens. Watch your breathing. The breathing out is as much as a part of breathing in, because you cannot breathe in if you stop breathing out. You cannot live if you stop dying. The man who has understood what life is allows death to happen, because he dies each moment, and every moment he is born again. He dies to the past each moment and he is born again and again to the present. Where there is death, there is life, or where there is life, there is death. Now, out of wrong understanding, out of fear, we have created a division. We think that life is good and death is bad. We think life has to be desired and death has to be avoided. We somehow think we have to protect ourselves from death. A person who protects himself from death is incapable of living, because if you have to live a full life, you have to be ready for death. Now, this chapter and the whole of Bhagavad Gita, we have told in the Bhajagovindam, Bhagavad Gita, Kinchid Adita. Now, we have learned from Kathopanishad that Yama Dharmaraja is not someone to be afraid of, but someone whom we hold as in the highest regards as a Brahma Vidya Acharya. And those of us who have spent a lot of time in Shiva through all these Kailash Yatras, Shiva could be our friend. And the more we surrender to Shiva, all of us could be like Markandeya to experience a sense of deathlessness. Now, that is how we are going to invest in the study of the Gita. And that is how we are going to study the 8th chapter to look for deathlessness. Om Purnamada पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ओम शांति 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 ओम सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिनः सर्वे सन्तु निरामयाः सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत् ओम शांति शांति शांति